I'm Dave Altig, the Director of Research here at the Atlanta Fed. It's my pleasure to be the moderator for this first panel today. Let me start with a question. So by show of hands, how many people think it's about time for the FOMC to start raising rates? All right, how many think it's about damn time for the... Well, certainly that's the question in the air, and there is... on the basis of the traditional goals of price stability, employment, growth, certainly a case to be made for one of these days soon doing such a thing, but it probably is indeed the case that the position of wanting to raise rates is buttressed somewhat if you add into the mix the question of financial stability and potential excesses that may arise by lingering too long at the zero bound. So that's one of the issues, that is the issue we're gonna take on this morning. Most of this conference, or certainly much of this conference, yesterday and then later today in a panel will be about how the shadow banking system alters the monetary transmission mechanism, how in turn regulation alters the shadow banking system, and then by right syllogism, how regulation itself affects the efficacy of our monetary policy tools. So it strikes me somewhat that there's a little bit of a two-way street in the conversation here, just as we ought to ask the question of how might financial stability concerns enter into the monetary policy decision in the sort of its traditional forms. Maybe we should also be asking the question of whether or not the cost-benefit calculus of people charged with macroprudential responsibilities ought to be influenced by how, in fact, those regulations alter the tools that we can use and how effective they will be. I'm not sure exactly whether we'll get to that question precisely this morning, but we are going to basically start the conversation about whether there we need to worry about the absence of a divine coincidence between financial stability concerns and monetary policy concerns. And to get to that, we have a wonderful panel. We will start with a paper by Martin Hellwig, director of the Max Planck Institute for Research on Collective Goods, followed by a panel of discussants who everyone knows and loves, but I will introduce them anyway. Jan Hatzius, Chief Economist and Head of Global Economics Research at Goldman Sachs. Charles Goodhart, Professor Emeritus of the London School of Economics, and a man who needs no moderation, David, or maybe will accept no moderation, Dave Zervos, Chief Market Strategist at Jefferies LLC. Fire up your pigeonholes. We're ready to go.
Thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you very much for the kind introduction. I would like to add one point to my qualifications. I'm also vice chair and was chair of the Advisory Scientific Committee of the European Systemic Risk Board, and in that function, member of the General Board. And some of what I have to say is driven by experiences I've made there. That being said, a point on terminology. I was a bit surprised in hearing Robert Rubin talk about the purpose of macroprudential policy being to deal with the shadow banking system. On the other side of the Atlantic, macroprudential policy is just that, macroprudential policy. And over the past year, as we've just seen the statistics, European institutions have implemented some 100 acts of macroprudential regulation, like increases in loan-to-value ratios for real estate loans and the like, very much for the conventional banking sector. So if I use the word macroprudential, I refer to it in that sense of the word. The crisis has made us all aware of the importance of central banks for financial stability, especially in situations where no one else is able to act, as unfortunately is the case in the euro area. So what's the role of financial stability in monetary policy? A question that will come up over and over in my talk. Answers are difficult to come by. If you look at the experience of the Swiss National Bank, they have a financial stability mandate since 2002. When I was involved in evaluating their financial stability group in November of 2006, mind the time, there were two observations that we made. One, communication between the financial stability group and the monetary policy group was zero. Two, the one point which with hindsight could have been very important, namely the financial stability group's nervousness about the extremely low equity ratios of their two national champions, or alternatively, their two systemic risks, Credit Suisse and UBS, with equity below 2% of total assets, those went completely unheard and didn't make it out even outside the Swiss National Bank. Complete non-communication. Another example, the ECB under Trichet. Financial stability concerns and monetary policy concerns are two things. Monetary policy deals with inflation, and you use interest rates to deal with that. Financial stability is something that you should use sparingly anyway because of moral hazard, and then you use unconventional measures. That stance explains the fact that the ECB raised interest rates in the summer of 2008 and again in the summer of 2011, even as a major crisis was threatening in Europe. Of course, under Draghi, this has completely changed. Now, on this side of the Atlantic, relations between standard monetary policy and financial stability concerns are not too happy either. If you look at the late 80s and 90s, in 87 and early 88, you have a flooding of markets in order to preempt a fallout from the crash. Then you get high inflation, so you get tremendously restrictive monetary policy in 89 with interest rates that have been unseen since the early 80s. When that was about to threaten the solvency of the major money center banks, you got a complete turnaround of monetary policy again. It's not exactly an example of what I would consider to be a sustainable long-run policy stance. If you go to other quarters, such as Hayekian fundamentalists or even some of the monetarists who have forgotten about the Great Depression, the simple policy prescription for central banks and financial stability don't. Monetary activism just creates moral hazard. I'm mentioning this because the deep distrust of government power that comes from control over fiat money plays a major role in the political debates. So for my talk, I want to bring through three points. The first one concerns a look back, where do we come from, and what's actually the tradition of central banking and financial stability. The second and third, challenges that we must deal with if we are to make sense of the subject. One, understanding what's going on. Two, be clear about what strategy we have and what priorities we set. Looking back, financial stability mandates were there long before any others. As Charles Goodhart has described it in his wonderful book, The Evolution of Central Banks. These financial stability mandates arose very naturally. In particular, a lender of the last resort function arose very naturally from the inability of private banks to deal with the public goods problems, the free rider problems inherent in handling a liquidity crisis. This was enshrined in Baggett's formula, lend freely to solvent banks against good collateral at penalty rates. I'll come back to that. It was a good business proposition. And after all, at that time, central banks had to worry about their business position. It was completely violated in the Great Depression. Basic issue, the gold standard, required that central banks had to take care of convertibility. So in the Great Depression, they took care of convertibility. And took care of their gold reserves. And those that tried to take care of financial stability concerns soon changed course again because gold began to flow out. This was the case of the Federal Reserve in 1932, when the open market operations led to an outflow of gold. In Eichengreen's assessment in his marvelous book, Golden Fetters, central bank behavior at the time was driven by the gold standard, and some central banks persisted in gold standard thinking even after they'd left the gold standard. I'm sometimes reminded of that when I look at some of the arguments I see in the discussion in Europe about what the central bank can do and cannot do. For example, the European Central Bank should not engage in quantitative easing because it might make losses on the assets that it acquires. The fact that as it acquires these assets, it makes a hidden gain, and that the loss can never be bigger than the hidden gain, has completely been forgotten. But this is what you get when you have people who come from first principles without understanding about the specific nature of fiat money. Now, post-depression, everything changed. In the US, the gold standard disappeared, and basically, you got a fiat money monetary system. In other countries, you also got a fiat money monetary system, but not really until the end of Bretton Woods, because before that, monetary policy was constrained again by the need to convert to maintain convertibility with the dollar at the given exchange rate. The Depression also led to the introduction of macro mandates: full employment, stable growth, price stability. But price stability was also due to inflation experiences. And the great debates of the 50s, 60s, and 70s about what's the role of monetary policy, monetary versus fiscal policy, inflation versus unemployment, all of that involves macro mandates, which have no longer anything to do with financial stability, at least on the surface of it, or with previous micro concerns of what the central bank was about. If you look at these macro debates in more detail, you find that mostly they are about activism versus opposition to activism in government policy. The Keynesian monetarist debate was driven by monetarist resistance to fiscal policy. The inflation unemployment debate was driven by resistance of monetarists against the use of inflation to deal with unemployment. In between, there was also a concern about fiscal dominance, interest rates targeting, distorting intertemporal prices, and implying a monetization of government debt, implicitly in the US, and of course very explicitly and very radically in Italy in the 70s and 80s. Some of this led to subsequent calls for central bank independence, which we have now.
Underneath these discussions, however, there always also has been a hidden financial mandate related to monetary transmission and the role of the banking system in determining money multipliers. The Friedman-Schwarz account of the Great Depression says monetary policy was contractionary, while the monetary base expanded by 15%. Yesterday at the table I heard, whenever you expand the monetary base, there's bound to be inflationary pressure. Friedman and Schwarz, this was contractionary policy. Why? Because M1 went down by 33%. So the monetary expansion by the central bank was insufficient to compensate the monetary contraction in the banking system itself. If you look at the years since 2008, you have strong expansions of the monetary base which don't feed into comparable inflation. In the case of Europe, you have a doubling of the base between 2008 and 2013 and a 10% cumulative increase in prices. Also, a 10% cumulative increase in M3. So some notion of a need to intervene to deal with instability with the financial system is inherent, even if in the anti-activist monetarist position to keep relevant money aggregates stable. It's a certain paradox. Now back to Badger. Solvent banks, good collateral, penalty rates. Draghi's long-term refinancing operation of 2011-2012, which forestalled a crisis that might have had the dimensions of 28. Involved banks of dubious solvency, poor collateral, and very low rates. And other central banks as well have violated the Badger rule. Rightly so? I believe so, because the Badger rule was to some extent predicated on the fact that the central bank was a business that must take care of its profits and loss statement. In a fiat money economy, we no longer are there. And sometimes it might even be necessary to support individual institutions, even though they are insolvent. In the paper, I give the example of the German Deinhard Bank in 1931. If they could have been saved, a lot of trouble would have been avoided. So where does that leave us? It leaves us with the statement that financial stability has always been a concern, to some extent implicit in macro mandates, and the ability of central banks to deal with that has been greatly affected by the shift from the gold standard to fiat money. That's, of course, what makes people afraid, the sheer power in being able to create a trillion or two of additional money at will is worrisome. So let me get to the challenges. I mean, my own view is that having a financial stability strategy is unavoidable because at the very least in a crisis, you can't help it. Challenges. A major part of the problems that we have is that we usually don't understand what is going on. If you look at the history of the crisis, you had early warnings by Rajan and Schiller. In early 2007, you had wonderful analyses of the subprime problem by the IMF and the BIS. And none of them had an inkling of what was to come. Why? Because the extent of the depth of the crisis was not due to the extent of the subprime problem, but due to contagion and systemic risk. The stuff was globally held, and the institutions holding it were highly levered and very vulnerable. Global contagion was also fueled by fire sale effects, driving down market prices feeding into bank balance sheets and requiring reactive defensive actions. The dependence on wholesale short-term funding, including the vulnerability to the double run problem in money market funds, customers running on reserve primary and the other funds, and the funds themselves withdrawing from the wholesale markets. All of those things were what made the crisis as bad as it was. Before the crisis, there was no systemic thinking. The scope of the vulnerabilities was unknown. For example, there was no information of how much was held in special purpose vehicles of regulated banks that tried to avoid equity regulation. There also was, and I'm afraid to say there is, no, and I literally mean zero, understanding of the implications of the fact that macro models and asset markets work on different timescales. Asset markets work in real time, and an asset market implosion can take place in days or weeks. Macro models are about flows, things that go slowly. The typical period would be a quarter or a year. And in terms of mere conceptualization, we have found no way to make these compatible. The term macroprudential is actually a misnomer because it suggests something on the order of the business cycle, on the timescale of the business cycle. But if you're talking about an asset price implosion, you're talking about days. Now, hindsight bias is, of course, a problem. But one might have asked questions before, such as, why did mortgage-backed securities and CDOs end up with banks and bank affiliates rather than insurance companies or pension funds? If you think about the theory of it, the problem of funding long-term investments such as houses is that this doesn't match the short-term horizons of final investors. But there are some investors who do have long-term horizons, who would have a comparative advantage in holding such stuff. Why didn't, though, namely pension funds and insurance companies, why didn't those investors invest primarily with priority in those newly created assets? Why did this end up with institutions that were very shortly funded? Why is there has there been so much short-term wholesale funding at all? And why was there such a decline in equity? Even between 98 and 2007, there was a significant decline in equity. Now, one needs to answer and follow up on such questions. And one shouldn't start from the observation which I read between the lines in some of the OFR publications. The system needs this. If I read a paper on shadow banking describing what shadow banking does and how useful all this is, I wonder why there is never the question asked, what are the risks involved? The systemic risks? What are the externalities? And to what extent is the complexity of the system merely a means of hiding risks? Where are the risks being hidden? If you look at the chain of transactions that went from deposits in money market funds through special purpose vehicles of several categories to mortgage banks and to the mortgage borrower, you see that there is an enormous amount of liquidity and maturity transformation involved. Yet all the participants thought there wasn't much of that. In Gorton, for instance, you can read subprime lending did not involve maturity transformation because the contracts were bound to be renegotiated. The problem of counterparty credit risk following the renegotiation never seems to have occurred. These things need a general equilibrium analysis that looks at the entire chain and doesn't start with the easy answers from looking at just one piece of the cake. So this is one of the challenges that we have, and my suggestion is that we really need, both in this country and in Europe, independent institutions that have a mandate to serve as a kind of devil's advocate, trying to ask, where are the risks hidden? Second challenge, we need clarity about priorities and strategies. So far, in Europe at least, the financial stability activities of the ECB have been subsumed under the price stability mandate, which is the only mandate mentioned in the treaty, except, well, to maintain monetary policy and the monetary system and the payment system. So the argument is we support banks because if we don't do that, we get a recession and a deflation, and a deflation is incompatible with price stability. That works as long as the two mandates, the two objectives, call for the same kind of action, which might also be true if you're in an inflationary phase, including one involving a real estate bubble. Doing something to fight the real estate bubble might also work to fight inflation. What about the current situation? You have weak banks and you have weak economies. What should we care about? What's the purpose of macroprudential policy? Make the financial system subservient to macro-political objectives, or protect the financial system from the macroeconomy? When I asked this question at the ESRB, I got four answers. One, the financial system should not be made subservient to macroeconomic policy. Two, it should do precisely that, especially in the euro area, where macroprudential policy is different from country to country and monetary policy is not. Three, there is no difference because if the economy does badly, so does the financial system. Four, there is no difference because if we don't clean the financial system up, we won't get a sustainable recovery in the economy. That just shows that the conceptual understanding of these issues is not based on any sort of clear thinking about how to resolve these conflicts. My own position, I'm very much in opposition to thinking of banks as tools of macroeconomic policy. Let me give an example. I'm deeply distrustful of the ECB's targeted long-term refinancing operation, where banks get subsidized loans or cheap loans from the ECB, provided they use that for lending to the real economy. That implicates the central bank in the commercial bank's asset allocation decisions, and they shouldn't be. Through the grapevine, I've heard that Mr. Greenspan, even though he didn't use formal programs, used the phone for similar strategies. If so, I think that was part of the lore about the Greenspan put, that if anything went wrong in the financial system, the central bank would take care of it. Are we in for a Draghi put? In terms of governance principles, I think that route is very bad for both sides. On the issue of how do we deal with the interdependence between the financial system and the real economy, I believe that this is to some extent an issue of timing. And my favorite examples for that are Sweden and Japan in 92. The Swedes said, let's clean the mess up. They got a sharp recession and afterwards a fast recovery and are happy to have done so. The Japanese said, let's not rock the boat. Let's not harm credit to the real economy. Let's exercise forbearance. That has been very costly because to some extent it implied that bad loans of established banks were maintained on the book at face value in order to show that these institutions were solvent. And the companies that had borrowed these loans were maintained even in cases where these companies were insolvent. And if you have deep pockets financiers funding unsuccessful companies, that does bad things for your growth prospects. Altogether, the literature tells us that fast intervention is very much desirable. In this context, I would like to point to a problem. Weakness of banks is a problem at the level of stock variables. If we rely on something like current profits to change that, as Mr. Greenspan did in 1990 when he allowed the banks to play the yield curve for a number of years, it takes time to repair the balance sheets. It's much preferable to deal with a stock problem at the level of stock variables, which means either restructuring or recapitalization. And we need to think about ways to do this. With forbearance, we may have problems, we may have a prospect that the problems persist. Excess capacity in the financial sector does not get reduced, and that compresses margin and harms the ability to earn profits. Right now, the ECB's quantitative easing, as well as forward guidance, in this country, Operation Twist on the yield curve, all have implications for the ability of the financial sector to earn profits and to reestablish their balance sheets. We need to think about these issues as we care about monetary policy in the crisis, so we need to take these in. The risk for monetary policy and arrangements of this sort is that it may be driven by financial dominance, the need to worry about unhealthy financial institutions for a long time. So, let me conclude with three suggestions. First, establish independent investigating units to discover what is going on, to play the role of devil's advocate. Second, restrict financial stability mandates to situations of emergency. And third, make sure that in such situations or after such situations, you clean up the mess as quickly as possible so that monetary policy can get back to normal without paying undue attention to the interests of the industry.
All right, thank you. I want to talk a little more about some of the practical issues, and I'm paraphrasing some of the conclusions in Professor Hellwig's paper, and want to think about under what circumstances monetary policy might want to tighten for financial stability reasons. And it seems to me that there are four questions that need to be answered. One, is there a big risk of a damaging bust? Is there an unusually high risk of financial instability? And if the answer to that is yes, then the next question is, are regulatory tools effective? If the answer to that is no, then the third question is, do higher interest rates actually reduce the risk of a bust? Is a monetary policy response actually effective? And then the final question, if the answer to that is yes, is the macroeconomy ready, or what are the macroeconomic costs of kind of deviating from tightening on the basis of financial stability considerations? So I'm obviously not going to talk about all of these things. I want to talk in a little more detail about question one, and then briefly about question four. I'm going to leave aside two and three, even though they're obviously very important. And specifically, I want to talk a bit about a practical attempt to estimate risks of a bust. And here's what we did. We looked at quarterly data for 20 OECD countries since the mid-1980s and basically defined an equity bust. We looked at equity busts and at housing busts separately. We defined an equity bust as a decline in real equity prices on a year-on-year basis by 20%. We also looked at more stringent definitions of a bust, ones that actually have significant macroeconomic consequences. So looked at recessionary equity busts, which combine a bust with a year-on-year decline in real GDP, either during the bust or immediately thereafter. And then also looked at deeply recessionary busts, where the year-on-year decline in GDP needs to be at least 2%. And similarly, looked at housing busts, with the only difference there being that the criterion for what constitutes a bust is lower because house prices aren't as volatile. So we defined it as a real 5% year-on-year decline. Then, in order to get at the sort of early warning aspect of this, we define an alarm as any quarter, 5 to 9 quarters before a bust quarter. And then we basically looked for economic and financial variables that correlate with an alarm. And the economic and financial variables are pretty standard: debt growth, valuations. We looked at volatility, equity volatility specifically, growth, inflation, investment to GDP ratios. So that's essentially the approach. Now, just to be clear on the dating of busts and alarms, here's an example of the US housing bust, which by this definition lasted from early 2007 to mid-2009. And then you can see the alarm quarters. The alarm period is somewhat longer than the actual bust period because we take any quarter, 5 to 9 quarters before the actual bust. So what are the results? Here are the regression results. All of the numbers, which might be a little difficult to see in the back of the room, all of the numbers are standardized coefficients. So we size the coefficients by the standard deviation over the sample. And the basic results for equity busts are that equity price growth matters a lot. Not surprisingly, if something that has gone up a lot is more likely to go down subsequently. House price growth matters somewhat. Credit to GDP ratio matters somewhat. Investment a high investment to GDP ratio or a big increase over the past 5 years is correlated with subsequent busts. And we also find that high equity volatility is correlated with subsequent busts. Not surprisingly, in some sense, if you have a lot of volatility, then the likelihood that you get a 20% decline during that period presumably goes up. However, it's interesting to look at equity busts, what happens to these results when we look at recessionary or deeply recessionary equity busts. We actually get somewhat different results in that case. Equity price growth no longer matters as much. So an actually macroeconomically damaging equity bust seems to be a somewhat different animal. It's not just the reversal of a previous bull market, but it seems to reflect other other issues with the economy, and for example, credit to GDP ratio is more important for recessionary equity busts. And it's also interesting that the predictive content of equity volatility actually changes sign. So if you look at deeply recessionary equity busts in particular, low equity volatility is predictive of something bad happening in the future, which I thought was an interesting result. Housing busts, I think you You can look at the numbers. Nothing hugely surprising here. The most important variable, and this is even is clearer for housing busts than for equity busts, is credit to GDP. That won't surprise anybody. Big increases in house prices obviously also raise the risk of a bust. And we do also have some correlation, which surprised me a little more, with high inflation being more predictive of house price busts. I wouldn't have necessarily guessed that before looking at the data. Those are the results. I want to talk about sort of two things. One, how good are these results in some sense? How good a job can we do on the basis of this type of analysis in predicting busts? And I'd say I have a sort of equivocal answer to that. And then I want to talk a little bit about what it means for where we stand currently in the United States. I have a somewhat equivocal answer in the sense that, you know, we do find a number of highly statistically significant coefficients, and I think mostly the results make sense, but the fit of the model isn't great, and false alarms are a significant issue, at least if you set the threshold for what constitutes an alarm such that you actually capture a significant share of all busts. So if, for example, if you set the threshold such that 75% of all actual crises, all actual busts are actually captured, you get false positives about half the time, a little more than half the time in the case of equity busts, actually, and still between one-third and one-half the time for housing busts. So that's not great, I would say, and it certainly says that this is not the sort of tool that you would want to use on autopilot at a minimum. A more systematic way of illustrating the sort of trade-off between type 1 and type 2 errors is to basically plot the percentage of crises or percentage of busts that are captured against the type 2 errors. And you can see that here for a few of the examples. In general, housing busts seem to be a little more predictable, especially deeply recessionary housing busts, so which of course we're probably most concerned about, just given the costs that those busts tend to impose. So that's perhaps somewhat good news, but there's still a significant number of type 2 errors if you want to set the threshold reasonably high. So what does all this imply at the moment? In order to talk about that, we basically show the predicted probabilities for the United States going back to 1985 using the model estimates. Here is the percent probability of a housing bust in the percent probability of a housing bust in the U.S. Both for all busts and for recessionary ones, and you do capture, I think, the general sort of pattern you'd expect: high risk of a bust in the late 1980s, and then again in the mid to late 2000s. You also do get a somewhat higher risk of a recessionary or deeply recessionary bust in the run up to the crisis than you did in the late 1980s. The numbers are not so impressive. If you actually look at the numbers on the scales, we never get above 30% on anything. So it might also be useful to look at this sort of an index form, just looking at the level at the probability relative to its own history. That I think makes it perhaps look a little more impressive, but clearly it's only one tool. If you look at where we are at the moment, not surprisingly, given what's happened to house prices and given what's happened to credit, we're at very low levels for bust risk at the moment. Here are the same sort of numbers for the equity for risk of equity busts. These are the raw probabilities. So some interesting divergence, in particular, in the late 1990s between the risk of an equity bust, which was very high, and the risk of a deeply recessionary equity bust, which wasn't nearly as high, even relative to its own history. So looked like more of a financial market dislocation as opposed to a really bad situation for the real economy to be in. And here is some the index version of this. So we're at approximately average levels of risk for an equity bust. The reason here is that there are two offsetting factors. Equity prices have risen a lot over the last 5 years. That increases the risk of a bust, but on the other hand, credit growth has been very weak. That lowers the risk of a bust, and those two factors roughly offset one another along with other things in the model. So my conclusion would be to translate this into current policy, risk of financial instability, at least on this basis, does not look particularly high. It looks very low if you're particularly focused on housing busts, and it looks about average when you're focused on equity busts. And then just a few observations very briefly to conclude on the fourth question, namely, what are the macroeconomic costs of increasing interest rates for financial stability reasons? And Dave asked at the start whether people in the room thought that it was time or high time for interest rate hikes. My own view is it's not yet time, and in my view, it's certainly not high time yet. Our forecast for the first hike from the FOMC is September. My opinion in terms of when monetary policy ought to be tightened is very late this year or early next year. So I'm basically in the Charlie Evans camp for some of the reasons that are well known. Potentially still a significant amount of labor market slack, despite a sizable amount of uncertainty. Weak wage growth, which I would view as a support for the idea that there may still be a significant amount of slack. Low core inflation, downside risks to global growth, and of course the currency appreciation that's related to that. The balance of risks at the zero lower bound, which in my view favors waiting longer. And then finally, uncertainty around the level of the equilibrium short-term interest rate, which is an argument for a later but potentially also steeper liftoff, according to a recent paper that I co-wrote with Jim Hamilton, Ethan Harris, and Ken West on the equilibrium interest rate. So I'll leave it at that. My conclusion is that the argument on financial stability or other grounds for tightening monetary policy at this point in time still looks relatively weak to me. Thank you.
I'm particularly grateful to Dave and the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta for asking me to speak on this particular date. It's very appropriate. Now, Martin began with a discussion of the interactions between the various parties involved in financial stability in Switzerland. Now, I want to begin with an equivalent discussion of the relationships between these parties in Sweden. In Sweden, the central bank, the Riksbank, whose governor is Sven Ingves, has responsibility, of course, for monetary policy, but it also has de facto and some de jure responsibility for financial stability as well. However, it doesn't have control over any of the instruments, or most of the instruments, because their financial services authority, or FSA, managed by Martin Anderson, has responsibility for microprudential and for most of the macroprudential instruments, particularly with regard to the housing market. Now, Governor Sven Ingves over the last 6 or so years has been very concerned about the fact that Swedish housing prices, as we heard yesterday, have continued to rise very rapidly, and that Swedish household debt-to-income ratios has been rising to extreme heights, and has feared that there could be a financial stability crisis as a result. Now, in this respect, he and Martin Anderson have a difference of opinion about how dangerous this might be and how severely macro-proof measures should lean against the expansion of the housing market and credit to that housing market. As a result, the governor, Sven Ingves, and until recently, towards the end of last year, the majority of their Monetary Policy Committee voted to keep interest rates somewhat higher than would have been desirable in terms of the best optimal trade-off between inflation and the output gap. This, of course, as many of you know, was much to the absolute fury of one of his deputy governors of the time, Lars Svensson. And the dispute between the two was bitter and protracted, really, over a number of years. Indeed, it wasn't until Lars Svensson had left the Swedish Riksbank and the Swedish economy, like much of the rest of the Eurozone, moved more towards deflation and continued stagnation, that the Riksbank changed its tune and lowered interest rates now to negative levels, to the kind of level that Lars Svensson would have liked. So you can see some of the problems that arise when you get macroprudential instruments under the control of an institution which is not ultimately responsible for financial stability. So one of the conclusions that I draw from this is that whichever institution is held responsible for financial stability should also have command over the major instruments to actually achieve that end. Now, in my view, it really has got to be the central bank that has control over, that is responsible for financial stability and has command over these instruments, if only because the central bank inevitably has control over the liquidity, overall liquidity in the system. Nobody else can really do that. I have a dispute with a friend and colleague, Willem Boete, who takes the line that it would be better if the central bank focuses only on its price stability mandate and provides or leaves financial stability issues to another body. When faced with the question of, but surely you need to have liquidity provision if you're going to be able to meet your financial stability, Willem suggests that this other body should have the ability to command and control a significant large part of the central bank's own balance sheet in order to use the central bank's balance sheet, whether or not the central bank desires it, for financial stability purposes. I can't imagine a single central banker who would actually sign up to that particular idea. So, if we're going to have a central bank with financial stability responsibility, it's going to be given more powers. That leads to the question of what are the boundaries of these powers? In particular, one of the areas where financial stability has persistently hit has been the housing market. And the question is, should a central bank intervene into something as politically sensitive as the housing market? Now, the way that the Financial Policy Committee in the UK has tried to handle this rather delicate issue is to limit its powers to what the banks should do. In other words, the FPC has not said that borrowers should not take out loan-to-income mortgages that are greater than X. What it has said is that banks should not provide loan-to-income mortgages greater than X. So that it has tried to restrict the limits of its powers to what the banks do in terms of mortgages. Now, this is all right in a system where the banks actually provide the great bulk of the mortgages, but what happens when you have mortgages provided by non-bank financial intermediaries in a world, in a system like the US, where the shadow banking sector is much higher. So the question then moves, particularly in the US, rather more than in the UK, which is how far should a financial stability central bank institution, how far should it have powers over non-bank financial intermediaries, both shadow banks and others, of which we heard quite a lot yesterday. And I think most of us will be fascinated by the result of the MetLife legal case about whether it should be designated as a SIFI, and how far the central bank should have powers over money market mutual funds and other NBFIs. And of course, it goes even further than that. And one of the key areas of financial stability weakness has been, and particularly in Europe, the ability of households to take out mortgage borrowing in foreign currency. And when that bet goes wrong, and the foreign currency appreciates against their domestic currency, they are left high and dry. And frequently, the banks from whom they have borrowed are left high and dry too. And that has been the case in Eastern Europe, Iceland, and other areas. Should a central bank have the power to tell households and maybe corporations that thou shalt not borrow in foreign currency format unless you are hedged by having a source of foreign currency earning? So the question of the limits of the powers of central banks in this field is a fairly difficult one, but one that I think will be important to try to answer. I must say in this context, I'm very much in sympathy with Martin's proposal that there should be an independent body to check on the financial stability risks and the financial stability measures that have been undertaken by the central bank. There's none in the UK, and I slightly wonder whether the OFR in this country and the ESRB in Europe are sufficiently independent of government to actually carry out an independent check of the kind that I and Martin would very much like to see. Now, let me end with another major issue. And Martin asks towards the end of his paper, on pages 22, 23, what do you do when there appears to be a conflict? In particular, when there's a weak economy and you have a weak banking sector. And he comes out very strongly in favor of trying to clear up the banking sector first and against forbearance. I must say I'm much more less certain on this than Martin. And one of my sort of main memories when I was an official in the Bank of England was that the real single greatest point of danger to the developed economy's financial system before 2008, possibly as great as 2008, was the Mexican, Argentinian, Brazilian, less developed crisis, LDC crisis, in 1981-1982. As you will recall, virtually every major city center bank in New York, on a mark-to-market basis, was bust, was insolvent. And many of the major European banks were in the same boat. And yet, by a process of forbearance, with encouraged evergreening by the authorities, we got through that particular crisis. The Latin American countries didn't, but we did. If you look at the list of crises, Reinhardt and Rogoff, the ones done by Lou Glavin and the rest of them, that LDC crisis, 1981-1982, does not even figure. Doesn't come. It's regarded as not a crisis because it didn't actually affect the economies because it was dealt with through a forbearance evergreening approach. One of the problems here is a statistical problem. The forbearance approach is meant to prevent a crisis. So when it works, you don't see it in the data of crises. It is only when forbearance doesn't work that you see it. So if you are just looking at crises, what you will see is forbearance doesn't work. What you really need in order to assess whether forbearance sometimes is the right path is to look at crises that might have happened but didn't. And I can tell you, having been working in the Bank of England for 15 years, that there were and are and have been a very large number of crises that didn't occur because the authorities took various steps, many of which included forbearance, to prevent them. And therefore, the normal statistical measures of whether you should forbear as compared to cut, close, and recapitalize are biased beyond belief. And it's actually very difficult to look at successful forbearance because the data remain confidential. You only get to know when forbearance has failed, effectively it hasn't worked. However, I understand the argument that you shouldn't do it. And I think that there is a good case to try and strengthen and recapitalize the banking sector first. But the question is not just the order. It's the way in which you try and do the recapitalization. The process of recapitalizing. Mark Carney, chairman of the FSB, or who was the chairman of the FSB, and many of the Bank of England, would say with great pride, what we have done is we have raised the equity ratios of the UK banking sector by a factor of 7. 7. Now that's one hell of a lot. Just how do you expect sort of a banking sector to expand borrowing at a time when they're being expected to raise the equity ratio by a factor of 7? And this is in a period, of course, when equity prices are extremely low, when there's a huge debt overhang, and where the incentive to raise an equity ratio is to do it by deleveraging. And in the process of trying to get the equity ratios high, particularly in Europe, there was relatively little pressure put on banks to raise it by new equity issues when all the incentives were against that. You only raise new equity because of the effect of dilution, your equity prices, your relationship with your shareholders. You only did it if your back was really right against the wall. It was done much better in this country because you used the TARP money. It's what should have been done. What should have been done in many cases was straightforward nationalization, recapitalization through the use of public sector money, and then sell it back to the private sector. And it wasn't done that way in Europe. And indeed, the stress tests, when they did the stress tests, they had no idea how they were going to deal with the banks that failed it. As a result, they couldn't operate stress tests effectively. Also, in the course of these last 5 or 6 years, a large number of measures have been undertaken one way or another that kept bank profitability relatively down. The yield curve has been flattened. And as has been reported before, and one of the factors leading to a recapitalization of the US banks after the 91-92 was the steeper yield curve. Well, the yield curve has been flattened. So that if you're doing maturity transformation, that actually weakens your profitability. There's been excessive, there's been massive levying of fines on banks. And the general idea that rather than on the people who actually undertook the inappropriate actions. And that effect has an effect on the macroeconomy as well, which is only just beginning to be understood. And finally, at any rate in my own country, there's been an encouragement of competition at a time when Martin Hellwig, for example, has argued that there's too much competition, keeping spreads and margins down. For all these reasons, what we have had is a situation in which the required equity ratio has been raised, and the result and the way it has been operated has been to do this by a massive great deleveraging. And the deleveraging, of course, has not been in the country of each national bank, because each government has said to its own banks, please delever, but do it abroad. So what we've had is a collapse of cross-border lending. The European banking system has ceased to be a system. It's been balkanized. It's been divided into bits. So I'm not again Martin's argument that the right sequencing should have been to strengthen the banking system. What I do say is that the way that the banking system has been strengthened has been disastrous, that it is effectively led to the European recovery being extraordinarily weak. And that if we're going to recapitalize the banks, and rightly so, because they were, as Martin says, grossly undercapitalized in 2007, 2008, for God's sake, think of how you do it in a way that doesn't really damage your own economy. And I think that you did it far better in the US, which is one of the reasons why your recovery, although weak historically, has been far greater and far stronger than the recovery in Europe. I think we made a total mess of it. Thank you.
Thanks, David. Thanks to the staff and the members of the Atlanta Fed. It's very nice to be back. I always enjoy getting a look back at a conference, and we had a very good time last year. Unfortunately, last year there was a lot of disagreement, so it was kind of fun. This one I'm finding a lot of agreement, and I'm finding difficulty finding myself in disagreement with anything that's been said so far. But I'll do my best to create some sort of controversy, since that seems to be the reputation that I have. I wanted to start out by sort of recalling the discussion we had last year with Jeremy Stein and Alan Meltzer, and the idea that Jeremy had put out there, and I think he had been an advocate of this over many years, that monetary policy should consider financial stability when these decisions are being made. And I've always taken the other side of that purely from a pragmatic sense. And the pragmatic sense comes from the fact that the monetary policy decision in and of itself is a really hard one. We don't know how much slack is really out there. We don't really know how to estimate these variables very well. Our models, FRB US, macro advisors, you name a big macro model, they're just, generally speaking, not particularly good at forecasting the future. It's just the nature of the beast. And I think to complicate monetary policy with yet another thing that we don't know a lot about, like financial stability, almost creates exponential or significant increases in the amount of policy mistakes that we could have. And I know that might be a little bit against the grain of the way some people are thinking, but I think a lot of people on this panel are trying to divorce some of the financial stability issues from the monetary policy issues, even if Jan's charts are really sort of okay with the idea, if you are at some point, you say, okay, ultimately I have to do it. But I go back to a couple of simple examples. I always think about 2003, 2004, when the Fed had turned the corner and we were advertising that rates were gonna go up. Rates didn't go up until June of 2004. And I think back, what would have happened if we started raising rates in March of 04 or in Jan of 04 or even the end of 03? Would the housing crisis never have happened? Would there have never been any subprime lending? Would none of that bubble occurred because we started 3 months earlier or we moved 25 basis points more? I don't think so. I don't think it had anything to do with the level of rates. And I don't think a lot of these crises have to do with the level of rates. Go back to 1998. Go back to all of the excesses that were in the system with long-term capital. Long-term capital was making huge levered bets when rates were at 5%. It didn't matter about the level, it was the spread that was being levered and the spread that was creating the systemic risk. And so this idea that somehow raising the rate is going to get in the way of the next levering of spreads that's going to contaminate the system and force an unwind strikes me as a long shot. So I would argue stay with monetary policy in the world that we know and love and understand that we're also in the middle of the greatest monetary policy experiment in history, so it's probably going to be a pretty hard one to get out of, and whether we use reverse repos and whether we can manage the IOER and whether we have Fed balance sheets that have issues when the interest on excess reserve might be above the coupon payment that's coming in on the balance sheet and all of those issues that we think about on the exit, I don't really know, and I don't think anybody in this room knows, and I frankly don't think anybody on the committee knows. And to add some layer of financial stability onto the back of all of that uncertainty strikes me as sort of just asking for trouble when there's already enough trouble to think about. But I would say that there ultimately is a role for the central bank, of course, in the financial stability arena. The lender of last resort structure exists for a reason. It's vested with the Federal Reserve, it's vested with the Bank of England, and it's vested in some sense with the ECB and the Riksbank. And so where do we go with financial stability? How do we think about the role of the central bank when it comes to financial stability? And the topic of this conference has been to kind of think about the shadows, where central banks kind of miss the bubble. They miss the excess. And I think that's the right approach. But rather than focusing on the shadow banks, I think you focus on the shadow banking activity. And where we've gotten ourselves into trouble is when the commercial banking system, which is the lifeblood of the economy, which is the highway system that our money travels on, that is the primary responsibility of the Federal Reserve's financial stability mandate, gets contaminated with highly toxic shadow banking activity. That's where the problem is. The problem isn't some guys with a lot of capital running out, levering themselves up, trying to create the next great idea and blowing up. That's capitalism. That's good. We want that to happen. We want people out there levering themselves on potentially good ideas. We don't want our clearing banks and our commercial banks and our payment system to be levering up on those good ideas. That was, in essence, the whole idea behind the Glass-Steagall Act, which I still, to this day, I know it's a point of contention for a lot of people, believe that a lot of what was done to repeal that act over the last 10 or 15 years was at least partially responsible for why we saw the contamination of shadow banking activity back into commercial banking activity. And let me give you some concrete examples of how this happened. I was working at a broker-dealer in the early 2000s, and I was not a mortgage credit guy. I was a macro strategy guy, looking at interest rates, but I was very focused on the mortgage market, and in particular Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, because they were driving everything in the interest rate markets as they were building up their portfolios, and they were hedging, and they were creating a lot of volatility in the overall markets. But I had mortgage credit guys sitting next to me, and my mortgage credit guys were making these bonds. I overhear these bonds that they're coming up with, and one of the guys goes, yeah, we just created a AAA security at LIBOR plus 160. Wow, AAA at LIBOR plus 160, rating stamped approval. Yeah, you know, we went to a bank, we said, a bank would love this. Went to a bank and said, you know, hey, would you like to buy this? LIBOR plus 160 AAA instrument. Bank's like, wow, that's great. They go back, they think about it, they call back, and they say, you know what, we can't really buy that. It's going to raise too many red flags with our risk department. But at LIBOR plus 80, we might be able to buy it. That's when the bells go off. Say, something's wrong. This is not right. There's an arbitrage. And you know what? You asked a great question, Martin. You asked a question which is, why weren't the insurance companies buying these long-dated assets? Why were banks buying them? Banks don't like long-dated liabilities. They're all about levering up a short-term trade, leverage and short-term. The reason is because we took housing assets and made them so expensive because the banks were buying them and levering them. We got that stuff. We got AAA CMBS and AAA RMBS to LIBOR plus 6 and LIBOR plus 8. And somebody was buying that at a bank, getting funding from their home office at LIBOR minus 20, booking a mark-to-market gain of 28 basis points, which was 2 points on a 10-year deal, and getting paid a bonus of 30 or 40% on the $2 million on the $100 million deal they just did. That was the trade. There was no reason why an insurance company would ever buy that because they don't operate with that kind of leverage. Now, how did the banks get away with doing this? Somebody at the Fed should have been like, hey, that's not right. You can't go out and do this trade. Aha. What do we uncover in 2008? That Citibank has 187 offshore Cayman Island registered vehicles. What are those offshore Cayman Island registered vehicles doing? They are issuing asset-backed CP to go out and buy LIBOR plus 8 paper. That is theoretically AAA. These were little money machines that had no capital against them. And they had no reporting requirement. That was the shadow banking system entering through the back door into the commercial banking system and creating the seeds of our crisis. It could have happened in other ways. It could have happened with exposures to AIG. It could have happened with prime services that were lending money to mortgage REITs that were levering themselves up. It could always end up back in the banking system. And I would argue, in a very simplistic way once again, financial stability, from a central bank's perspective, starts and ends with commercial banks. Commercial banks are the lifeblood. Commercial banks are the payment system. Commercial banks are necessary for finance to function. Allowing those commercial banks to engage in activity that can unwind them very quickly, force sales of their assets, deplete their capital, destroy their confidence, send them to the discount window, either en masse or on their own, is something we should avoid at all costs. That was the seeds of 2008. That was the seeds of the 1930s. That was the seeds of every banking crisis, is when we let our banks do something in a highly levered way that in unison unwinds itself in the marketplace. And I'm not sure, you know, where the lines get drawn between the shadow banks and the commercial banks. We might be able to have some well-defined regulation that allows certain type of activities to be quarantined off and not look back to the holding company level. That's something for the lawyers to figure out. But in a very simplistic sense, it strikes me as overreach for the central bank to come in and say, shadow banking activity is something we need to have our hands in at all times. I would hate to have an economy where I was telling entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley, or entrepreneurs in the Balkan Shale, or entrepreneurs at a biotech firm in Boston, how much leverage they can employ on the idea that they have. And if private capital, not FDIC-insured bank capital, private capital wants to fund that idea at a 10 or a 12% yield, with lots of covenants and lots of looks and lots of different structure, we should always let that happen. That's how we're going to grow. That's how technology advances. That's how the next business cycle upswing takes place. And what I worry about is financial stability, overreach, coming in and putting too much of a dampening factor on the markets, the real capital markets. And I wonder still today if we haven't already gone too far. If that the macroprudential regulations and the financial stability fuss that everybody's focused on hasn't already created a kind of stifling that has been part of the reason why we have debates about secular stagnation between Larry Summers and Ben Bernanke. Another good one today, by the way, if you haven't read it. And Larry's response. They're really going at it in the blog sphere. It's pretty fun. I think Someone made this point to me at a conference where they argued, and I don't have a great model for it, one of these guys could probably come up with it much better than I can, that basically said macroprudential regulation in and of itself creates more financial instability. And their argument was that it dulls the impact of monetary policy. So the monetary authorities put all this stimulus in, but there's this macro pru on the side holding it back. And it finds these nooks and crannies to go into. It bubbles them up. You can't really see them in the corner, but you don't see it in the main economy because you're really dampening the effects. So you have to put more and more. You have to do QE1, QE2, QE3, QE3 with thresholds, Operation Twist, everything, every piece of spaghetti on the wall. But the reason you're pushing so hard is because you've pushed this macro prudential policy into the entire economy, as opposed to focusing it on the one area that matters for the Fed, and that actually really matters for the economy, and that's the commercial banking system. I don't think that anybody coming out of the Great Depression was wrong to think about divorcing aspects of commercial banking and investment banking. I think that was a very astute observation post the Great Depression. And the Glass-Steagall Act was only 30-some pages long. We have a Dodd-Frank Act with 2,000 pages that came out of our crisis. And I'll guarantee you that on every page of that document, there is a financial arbitrage waiting to happen. There's somebody out there that can figure out a way to get around the regulations so that a commercial bank will figure out a way to get in the shadows and make spread without paying capital charges. They're too smart. They get paid too much. And it will happen again. And money will get created, the shadow money concept will get created in a way that has nothing to do with anything we're talking about at this conference. You know, I go back to the internet bubble. And I remember writing papers and writing discussion pieces on the creation of Palo Alto basically creating money. You know, we've never been able to control a money aggregate because the market endogenously creates money all the time. You worked at Qualcomm, you got some options, you're worth $100 million, you can't sell them for 3 years. But you know what? You could go to a bank and say, look what I got. Or you could hire a bunch of kids and say, I'm not going to pay you anything other than minimum wage, but I'm going to give you options. That's cash. That was as good as cash. People valued that. It was a medium of exchange. It was a store of value. It was money creation through equities. How did that ever get measured in monetary base, M1, M2, or M3? It didn't, but it was used for transactional purposes. We are constantly creating shadow money in different places, whether it's in housing-related structured assets or equity options, and we'll find others. It's just the nature of how capital markets operate and innovate. And I don't necessarily think it's a bad thing. It's only a bad thing when you let that shadow money and that shadow banking activity fester and lever itself up inside of a commercial bank with FDIC-insured deposits that is effectively a systemic part of the payment system of the country. And in 2008, those banks held the US economy hostage for nearly $1 trillion so that we could keep the payment system going. To me, it's the responsibility of the Fed to never let that happen again and to focus all of its financial stability efforts not on whether we're going to have a big upswing or a big downswing, or whether we're going to create too many Cisco routers or build a few too many homes outside of Las Vegas. That's the nature of the beast. We get too optimistic, we get too pessimistic all the time. Business cycles happen. Arthur Burns and Wesley Mitchell documented it many years ago. It's good. We should embrace cycles, and we should embrace even some of the bubbles around those cycles. That's how innovation happens. But we shouldn't let it get back into our commercial banking system. And I think we should also not spend a lot of time thinking about how to use monetary policy to stop that financial instability. We should think about it from a business cycle perspective. And if we see a lot of equity market returns very fast, or housing market returns very fast, or a lot of wealth creation very fast, we should probably, as monetary policy authorities, think about pulling the plug a little bit, taking away a little bit of the punch. Economy might be a little frothier than we think. You know, the S&P's gone up over 100% in the last 4 or 5 years. It's a pretty big number. European equities are up 40% in the last 4 months. I would look at that. I would think about that. But not from a macro pru perspective. I would think about that just from a pure business cycle perspective and say, you know, forgetting kind of this decision of whether we raise rates early because of financial stability, maybe we're supposed to raise rates in June or September because we're not supposed to be at zero anymore because we have a 5.6% unemployment rate and we've been pretty successful at actually generating a reasonable recovery in this economy after a lot of hard work. That's a fair argument. That's an argument based on the economy, based on measurements of slack, based on measurements of where we're going, and kind of being prudential with a tool, the monetary policy tool, which I consider to be the most powerful tool in our economic policy toolkit. And I would hate to abuse it and see it abused in a way that it becomes restricted because people have overstayed their welcome with the power of monetary policy. And I worry about that as well, given the political debates around the Fed. So I'm happy to open it up to questions. I guess what I would say is, in response to everything that was set up here, I think it's great to divorce monetary policy from financial stability. I think there's a huge role for the Fed in financial stability. I think it involves being all over the commercial banking system and making sure that they stay out of the shadows. Thank you.
I don't have the same collateral as Bob Rubin, so Dennis wouldn't lend me his watch. We'll get right to the questions, I think, and I'll just go with the most popular ones and see if we can get through those to some degree. So the first one is basically one of the many "what is to be done" questions. I don't know why this isn't coming up. I did. So here's the question, and I'll just read it. Agreed that central banks must do whatever is needed during a crisis, but what about the role of monetary policy creating the crisis? What risk does the size of the Fed balance sheet pose going forward? And a related question is, are we keeping interest rates too long and therefore increasing the probability of some financial Armageddon pending? Whoever wants to jump in.
I think the term monetary policy creating the crisis is exaggerating. The main point I had about the 2008 crisis was that it was systemic and that most of the mechanisms that were at work were unknown before. And in a sense, it isn't just a question of a real estate bust, but it's a question of how is this being propagated. And on that, the central bank does very little. In Jan Hatzius's presentation, there was a comparison equity versus real estate. My reaction to that would be that in the present context, monetary policy, equity bubbles, equity booms and busts should be regarded as irrelevant because over the past century, including 29, their macroeconomic and monetary impact was small. It's the combination of real estate and banking problems and the contagion effects involved in those that have been worrisome. These are the ones that we have to care about. On that, I agree with David that it wouldn't have mattered very much if the Fed had raised interest rates a few months earlier in 2004. But it would have mattered if the various regulatory authorities that are involved, and unfortunately in this country they're so fragmented that it's difficult to get coordinated action, if the various regulatory authorities involved had earlier on understood what the systemic risks were, what the contagion risks were, and what might be done about it.
Anybody else want to add anything?
Yeah, I mean, I agree that equity busts are less dangerous than housing busts. That said, I think at least in the U.S., and I think this is a little more true here than in Europe, big moves in equity prices have effects on financial conditions that can have can imply significant fallout in the economy. But you know, clearly there is an imbalance. I'd say, you know, in terms of monetary policy creating the conditions for a crisis, I would broadly agree with David's view that it probably doesn't matter a whole lot, but I probably wouldn't be quite as absolute about it. I'd leave the option that easy monetary policy might create financial instability at some point. So I do think it's something that you would want to monitor, but I think the hurdle should be pretty high, as discussed earlier.
I think that the BIS critique.
Sorry?
The BIS critique of monetary policy, that creating asset bubbles is not necessarily the right way of dealing with a generic wage price deflationary pressure, is well-founded. The problem is, what else do you do? So the BIS critique, I think, is correct. But the question is, what alternative policies could have been put in place. And I must say that I continue to be worried, because we are in the middle of creating the largest carry trade by what are policy measures that the world has ever seen. And the carry trade involved is that the central banks, particularly the ECB, is providing money to the banks who are trying to get out of their difficulties, particularly in Southern Europe, by buying government bonds. With the result, as Robert Rubin said last night, that we have a situation in which Spanish and Italian bond yields are below those of T-bonds. And this is artificial. And this is as much blowing up assets as blowing up assets through housing prices financed by easy credit, or blowing up equity prices. The question that arises and that worries me is that what happens when this bubble deflates in a condition in which there is relatively little liquidity in bond markets more generally?
I guess I would only recall the Alan Greenspan quote that I think he said something to the effect of equity market downturns have predicted 9 out of the last 1 recessions, and I don't think that there was ever a great correlation between significant distress on Wall Street and significant distress on Main Street. We've had one in 2008 that was fairly epic, but looking back at the 2001 equity bubble pop, which was a very, very large loss, in fact, a larger dollar loss in terms of wealth than the loss associated with the housing bubble, I think if you looked at the revised statistics now, we never even got 2 back-to-back quarters of negative growth after that equity market correction, which was, again, one of the largest in post-World War II history.
So I think we'll can try to squeeze in one more question. I think not working too well, but here's the question. How effective, this gets to something Charles alluded to, how effective can be the FSOC or the ESRB in Europe, as they can only rely on soft law to coordinate several agencies having their own agendas?
I think I pass this to Martin, since he's been involved in the ESRB.
The ESRB, for the moment, is far from the sort of institution that I envisaged, because it has no resources. The ESRB, in principle, has a secretariat and is supposed to be provided the resources from the ECB and from the different supervisory institutions and central banks involved. They work together on reports in the so-called advisory technical committee. In each of those reports, there always is a strong element of politics involved. I actually co-chaired an expert group on sovereign exposures whose report was recently published. I can tell you this was a major warfare against some interested parties to ever get this through. If you look at the general board is something like, well, what the diet of the Holy Roman Empire must have been. All the central bank governors, all the supervisors, European institutions, plus then three people from the advisory scientific committee. Highly ritualized, and there is nowhere the resource to just sit back and ask an independent question, what's happening right now, and have some people power devoted to investigating that question. Leaving aside the data problems, any request for data to the individual institutions, which are of course masters of the data, is a major exercise.
Well, with that, please join me in thanking the panel.